generation, the one, the only, Hayden Elliott. Welcome to The Buzz.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to The Buzz, a new live podcast. This is episode 2. Give us a cheer if you were here the last time. Woo! Give us a cheer if you enjoyed it last time. Woo! Okay, so last time I started the beginning of the night off with some jokes that were a little, they centered around noncery, actually. And, you know, I was told not to do that. So what I did... What I did instead was I got ChatGPT to write my intro. I'll tell you what I put into ChatGPT to generate this intro. I'm a very polite man, so I said, hello, I'm wanting an opening monologue for a talk show podcast. Think Jimmy Fallon, but he's a Geordie. It needs to be topical, using headlines from the past month, Newcastle United coming fourth in the Premier League and entering the Champions League for the first time in 20 years. The coronation of King Charles, the writer's strike happening against AI writing tools like yourself, and anything else in your infinite knowledge you might know about in the past month. Thank you very much. ChatGPT has wrote this intro. It's not sponsored. Ladies and lads, welcome to the talk show podcast that's about to give you more Geordie crack than ever before. I'm your host, the one and only Geordie Jimmy Fallon. Here to bring you the funniest banter and keep you in the loop on what's happening around the tune and beyond. Let's dive straight into the headlines that have been causing a stir. First off, how about them magpies? Newcastle United, our beloved black and white warriors, I haven't read this. have defied all expectations and soared to a jaw-dropping fourth place in the Premier League. It's like watching a Geordie Seagull rise above the rest, leaving fans in awe and rivals scratching their heads. And guess what, lads? It's been a whopping 2 decades since we last graced the Champions League stage. But we're back. Newcastle is ready to take on the big guns of Europe, armed with passion, pride, and more than a few pints of Newcastle brown ale. How are the lads? But hey, it's not all battles. But hey, not all the battles are happening on the football pitch. In a monumental moment for the monarchy, we witnessed the coronation of King Charles. It's like a, royal Geordie party with fancy hats and the sound of champagne corks popping. Long live the king, or as we say in Newcastle, why I war, Charlie? I wonder if the king has a soft spot for Greggs and a knack for speaking Geordie. We'll have to wait and see. Now, on to a headline that's a bit closer to home. You see, there's been a bit of a writer's strike happening against AI writing tools like me. Can you believe it? Some folks are concerned that machines like myself are taking over the world of creativity. But let me tell you, I'm just here to lend a helping hand, adding a Geordie twist to the madness. After all, no algorithm can capture the spirit of the tune quite like a true Geordie lad or lass. And as always, there's been plenty happening in the world outside of our beloved Newcastle. From mind-boggling technological advancements to the latest viral sensations, it's been a whirlwind of a month. I mean, they have the internet, like nothing specific. We had robots dancing, billionaires racing to space, and influencers trying to break the internet with their outrageous challenges. It's like the world's gone mad, but in the best possible way. So sit back, grab a stotty, and get ready for the podcast like no other. We've got a sensational guest, hilarious skits, and surprises that will have you laughing so hard your sides will ache like you've just climbed up Gray's Monument. From the heart of the tune, this is your Geordie Jimmy Fallon signing on. Let's have it, pet. I mean, it's not bad. Like, I mean, could have done with a second rewrite, maybe. Come in, it's all right. You just missed my opening monologue, it's fine. It's all right, I got ChatGPT to write it. But come on, I got to mention nonces, right? Like, I mean, if there's not a month for nonces, you know, because... come on, like, we had a... oh, what's his name? Rolf Harris. Rolf Harris, right? He's just died, hasn't he? Literally just died, like, 2 days ago or something. Yeah, are you sad? Is that came to a bit of a shock to you? Yeah. Not Rolf. just someone who's never stayed up with Rolf Harris. like news, like, past, like, 1990. Nah, he was a bit of a, you know. I mean, he should have been arrested for his song, Two Little Boys, right? Like, that's when we should have knew. You know? Or when he started playing that fucking thing on the stage. Like, if that... What is... Has it got an actual name or is it just a bit of cardboard? A wobble board. That's not a name of something. That's not a name of something musical. That's just him going, well, I'm a bit of a nonce, better do some music. A wobble, 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 wobble. And then Philip Schofield. Ooh. I won't go into it, but I didn't invite him tonight. That's all I'm saying. And I guess that's it. I had to mention it. I had to. Come on. But we got a great set lined up. We got some names in the hat, and we are ready to get rolling. Who's ready for a great show? Woo! Yeah? Okay, so please. Everybody, the great, the wonderful, the indescribable John Doe.
Feeling tonight? Good, yeah? Sehr gut. Das ist, what I like to hear. I am so very happy to be here at the infamous Buzz podcast. Word of your hilarious and very, very smart comedic show has reached the nondescript and unheard of part of Germany in which I am from. You will, for this reason, not recognize my accent as being very, very accurate to this specific part of Deutschland you will not have heard of. My name is Michael Maus, and I am of no relation to the Disney rodent. Okay, now that is out of the way, we can continue. I was recently voted number one in my town for the telling of the ha-ha funny jokes. And for my amusing collection of hats, which, as every comedian knows, unequivocally indicates to the audience that they are to laugh. We will try this now, yes. No, you are wrong, sir. Yes, you are very obedient. This will work very well for me. Thank you. After this blinding success, all 47 of the townspeople raised a staggering €38.99 to fly me here to make my international debut and to take Europe by storm. Not like that. Humor is a very, very serious subject to the Germans, and so to maximize efficiency, I will segue seamlessly to the jokes. Who here has a displeasing mother-in-law? Yeah, you do. My mother-in-law has acute diabetes and the fever of the hay. I always cheer her up with chocolate und Blumen. Again. Whenever I'm with my mother-in-law, I wonder who is running hell in her absence. This joke is funny, yes, because I am insinuating that my mother-in-law is the devil. I took my mother-in-law out the other day. I love being a sniper. This one, it speaks for itself, yeah. How many mother-in-laws does it take to ruin a marriage? Just one, mine. This is, in fact, not a joke. This is just a true statement of facts. I'm, in fact, undergoing divorce proceedings from my wife, Letitia. My mother-in-law has poisoned her against me. She will not break my spirit or take my hats. Now it is time for me to tell you a funny anecdote about my life. As a boy, I spent many summers in the beautiful Black Forest of Baden-Württemberg. One of these summers was spent hiking with my mother and father and my younger sister, Minnie. Why is this funny to you? On this particular occasion, the weather was excellent and the altitudes were sufficient for successful uphill walking with minimal impact to lung capacity and functionality. It was very good. I was a very happy boy. After a few hours of walking, we decided to stop for lunch, my father taking a confident and powerful stance upon a rock so he could navigate the map. It was then that I noticed my sister Minnie had wandered off somewhere and I was looking for her. Where has she gone? Minnie, where are you? I looked behind me to see that Minnie had wandered down a small path between the trees leading into the woods. So naturally, I followed her, keeping a swift pace in my sensible Birkenstock. When I caught up with her, it felt like we had been walking forever. And it was then that Minnie turned to me and she said, "Can you smell a sweet scent in the air?" And I said, "Yes, Minnie, I can. It smells like a big cookie. It's almost like a large structure of gingerbread." And there, before our eyes, as my nostril had predicted, there was the most beautiful gingerbread house. So hungry and tired, Minnie and I, we began nibbling and savoring the deliciously crisp and slightly spiced load-bearing walls. Then suddenly from inside the house, out stepped an old crone who said to us, "Oh, I have the most delightful supporting beams freshly baked for you if you are to come inside some door frames also for your consumption. If you come into my abode..." So naturally, being obedient children, we did this. So we are inside, we are nibbling. The old crone, she is massaging our weary bodies with some sort of oil-based rub. She said that she had made herself. I mentioned that it smelled a bit like a meine Mutter's barbecue marinade. And we laughed and we laughed. Long story short, this hag, she was a witch. Her intentions were very much to be eating of our flesh. Yes. Who'd have thought, am I right, guys? So next thing you know, I'm in a cage. Surrounded by what I can only assume are the discarded bones of other dismembered children. With sprigs of rosemary behind my ears and eine Kartoffel, how do you say, a potato in my mouth. I notice the old hag. She is by the big oven door, and she is saying to Minnie, "Oh, Minnie, would you be so kind as to take a look and see if the fires are hot enough at the back of the machine where I'm wanting to make my pies?" Oh, Minnie. My mother, she always used to say, "Sie hat nicht mehr alle Tassen im Schrank." She has not all the cups in the cupboard. Anyway, she died. Uh-oh, you know what that means. It is the time of the hats.
Hat time, everybody. Hey, yo, Jack, turn the music up.
I see a hat in here I've not seen before. Who is this furry fellow? Let me have a look. Surprise hat for me? Oh, wow. What is this? Who has done this? I come here to bring you nothing but smiles and laughter, and you have betrayed me in the most vicious of ways, besmirching my good sister's name. You should be ashamed of yourselves. I have nothing more to say to you.
You've ruined this for yourselves. Mikhail Mouse, everybody. Hello, Mikhail. How are you?
Oh, well, you know what? To be fair, I have not had the most generous of greetings since I have been here.
Oh, yeah? How come?
Well, you know, everyone I meet, they say, Mikhail Mouse, your name is Mickey Mouse. You think I don't get this enough?
And you seem like a little perturbed by that.
My life has been a tragedy.
So you like none of the works of Mickey Mouse?
I like Steamboat Willie. This is very amusing to me.
Can you do a rendition of that?
But of course, this is my bread and butter, sir. I don't remember the rest, but there's a man in it who is
everybody.
Very angry.
Come on, that was pretty good. So,
thank you. See, my one fan, he is from Germany also.
And so, speaking of Germany, which underscript and specific part of Germany is that your accent's from?
A good question for you, yes. It is the very, very small part that is between sort of, I would say, the north and the south. But also not too far west, but also just a smidgen from the east.
It does sound very specific and underscript.
Yes, thank you. You have been?
No, I haven't. But, you know, I'd like to go. Maybe we could go and visit the other mouses.
My parents are dead.
Cousins?
My cousins will be there, yes.
Okay, great.
I think we could go on a nice cycling holiday.
Okay, is that what you like to do in your spare time, cycling?
I love to cycle, yes.
Wow.
Very much so.
And how many kilometers do you normally cycle?
500.
Over what space of time?
3 days and 40 nights.
Okay. That set the tone for this interview. And so, what is it about the hat that makes it so amusing? And how many hats are in your hat collection?
A very good and intelligent question from you, sir. Thank you very much. I appreciate this. In my hat collection, I should say there is probably over 1,000, but in the divorce, I am likely to lose about 50% of these. So, I am currently looking for places to hide my hats.
So you're looking for like almost like an offshore hat sort of storage location.
Storage society, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And are there many of them? Have you came across any of them in your research?
I have found if I get a very big wooden chest, I put my hats in it and then I sink it to the bottom of the ocean. This is very good. I make a map, I mark it with an X, and then I find it later.
And your soon-to-be ex-wife, she is...
Letitia.
Yeah, but she is after the hats, actively?
She wants the hats.
Is she trying to take you for all your hats?
She's trying to take me for all of my hats, but she will not get the hats. Not the deer stalker.
And there was a moment on stage where it seemed like... Because obviously, it must have took some time to grow that mustache of yours, which is a wonderful mustache.
Thank you.
But it seems even now, like it still maybe trips you up a little bit.
Dankeschön. This is very correct, yes. Well, you see, I have it is a plight that I have had to bear since I have been 8 years old. I have been able to grow very thick and lustrous facial hairs. I have nothing below, though. completely bald. It is all on my face.
It's from like the lip up.
Of course, yes.
Right, yeah, that makes
sense. I have very hairy nipples, though.
Oh, okay.
It's a German thing.
I can just imagine that they just look like your Tash.
They do.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. And so you
are looking very well put together
No. I was gonna ask Letitia. So was it the mustache that Letitia was first attracted to?
Yes. She is a woman who likes a very burly man. I don't know if you can see, but that is obviously me in spades.
Yeah, the Birkenstocks are definitely.
They are the lovemakers.
Okay.
You put the Birkenstocks on, you are making babies.
And what's your thought on Crocs?
Crocs are for fools who have given up on the life.
Okay.
Crocs cannot offer you arch support.
That's fair. You know what? That's a very, very well researched opinion on Crocs, actually.
Thank you. I like to be quite thorough.
I can see.
I've got to ask: do the Birkenstocks, are they just for the seduction, or do they stay on during the deed?
They stay on for the deep penetration. Is this what you're getting at?
That extra grip.
Because if so, then yes.
And the socks as well.
But of course. I'm a gentleman.
And so it seems like you're not the biggest fan of your mother-in-law.
No, she's a difficult woman, very attractive.
Yeah?
Yes.
Yeah.
This is what caused most of the problem in her.
Do you think some of it's jealousy of the Tash?
She has a very substantial mustache herself.
Uh-huh.
But it cannot rival mine, and I think this irks her.
Oh, and you think so actually do you think the beef was because of both of your Tashes?
Yes. I believe so, yeah.
Okay, that's pretty much all for questions, but since you're visiting, I have a little option for you, right?
Yes.
Because I obviously know in Germany you like your beer.
Oh, yes, very much so.
Very much so?
Yes.
And you also like sparkling water. I don't know if a lot of people here know this, but actually sparkling water in Germany is more popular than regular water.
Mm. You cheer for this?
Wrongins.
Cheer for this now?
I'm telling you, I think only 1% of the audience is going to cheer for that. But
Wunderbar!
So yeah. I brought the option of sparkling water,
mm-hmm.
or in my little fridge here, a bottle of German Pilsner.
Oh,
now,
yeah.
I think it would be very interesting. I don't know about this audience here, but I thought it would be very interesting to see you down one of them.
Yes. Okay.
Should we let the audience decide? Or yeah, I think we should let the audience decide.
Either way, I am being sick today.
Audience, please, by a round of applause and cheering, should Mikkel Maus down this lovely bottle of German Pilsner. Or this very, very lukewarm bottle of Italian sparkling water.
Oh, this sounds very nice to me.
Oh, no one is cheering. I think we have the German Pilsner. This is the second time on this podcast, you know, the second time it's ever happened, that I forgot to bring a bottle opener. Does anyone have a bottle opener? Or do I need a...
Oh, you do not
do
have
I need
this?
A...
Oh,
oh,
this is a shame.
Oh, no, it's happening. This is a drinking podcast, so please, everyone, find an excuse to drink. If anyone gets on stage, I will give you a drink. You got later. Go on. Hey, everybody, round of applause.
Did you just ask for your own round of applause?
No, for the bottle opener. It's not a good one.
I thought it was for the catch, man.
Oh, well, it was a good catch. Round of applause for the catch. Okay, right. Should we get like a little bit of like a drum roll going? Do you want to stand?
How you're doing this? Do you swirl it?
Do whatever you want. How you do it in your non-specific part of Germany. We're not leaving until it's gone.
There's so much mustache in my mouth. It is wet and it is turning into some sort of paste.
John, maybe we need some drinking music. What was that German music that we had on before?
Wet since I have been with Letitia.
Well, you could do better than this.
This is going to be a very slow segment. Oh God.
Yeah.
My mother, she is going to be so proud of me. Oh, I'm not even halfway.
I believe in you.
Oh, we're getting there. We're getting there. Oh, Mika Mouse has found his stride. Everybody, we're down in the last quarter now. Oh.
Keep the music.
The music was definitely helping.
Oh, I thought we were done.
Mika Mouse. Hey! Ladies and gentlemen, Mika Mouse!
Thank you very much. And the Ryanair flight to catch.
Do you want to take your bike there, Mika?
Goodbye. Wow.
What an interesting character. What an interesting character that man is. Now's the part of the show where we take some audience members. I'm just going to shuffle these up a little bit. We're going to take one. We're going to just chat on stage. So let's see here. Who's this? Alex. Everybody, Alex Opel.
Yeah. Hello.
Hi, Alex. How are you?
I'm doing very well. I'm in a nice summer mood.
Oh, yeah? So what gets someone like you in a nice summer mood?
Well, I enjoy all of the seasons, of course, as any person who enjoys life should. But, you know, a little bit of sunshine.
Okay.
Brings you immense joy.
Would you like a beer? I've got some Doomba. I've got some Italian beer.
I'll have one of your Italian
bottles
of beers.
Beer, oh, nice. Here we go. And I did run off just to get my own bottle opener because the one that was thrown to me was shit.
Thank you very much.
You're up next. You know, you're up next, and you're doing one of my challenges, definitely. Okay, Alex, so you love all the seasons equally?
I'm quite a wintry man, because I'm of the opinion...
You wear a lot of layers.
Yeah, I like the more coats and layers you can wear, the better, you know.
And if there could have been a year that you were in winter in? Like, it looks like, to me,
what, the
like
best
76.
The best winter of all time.
Yeah.
Probably like the Roman days, you know.
Oh, really? Really? That's you what, fancy yourself
I
as
suppose
a
if you're asking when I would like to travel back in time to see what was going on.
At winter?
Yeah, probably like, you know, when Julius Caesar was talking about.
You know, didn't the Romans whip themselves for the cold with the...
Flagellation.
What?
That's what you call it, isn't it?
Oh, flagellation. I thought that was...
That's flagellation, I think, isn't it? Is it the other way around? All right. Well, I've just embarrassed myself on YouTube.
It's going other places, ladies and gentlemen. It's not staying on YouTube.
Delete this part.
Spotify one day, hopefully, maybe. And so, Alex, what do you do? What's your shtick?
I write songs, do a bit of DJing, yeah, but primarily write a bit of funk and soul music.
Funk and soul. Wow.
That's my thing.
Anyone here like funk and soul? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Very popular. John, do you like funk and soul?
Yeah, it's pretty good.
What's some of your sort of favorite go-tos in the funk and soul sort of genre?
I don't know, like maybe listen to some Parliament, or if I'm listening to some soul, put some Marvin Gaye on, you know.
Also. Excellent, excellent choices.
Thanks, man.
And you're a fan of Marvin Gaye yourself?
Of course.
Yeah? What's some of your favourite sort of factoids about Marvin Gaye? Do you have any?
He was not gay.
Oh. Oh. Is that breaking news? I don't know if that's breaking. Has anyone talked about this before? Marvin Gaye.
No,
not
he was.
Gay.
He was. No, he was murdered by his own father.
Yeah, he was, wasn't he?
Bullied his dad into killing him.
He gave his dad
his gun and then proceeded to beat his dad up for weeks on end until his dad shot him.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. That's a light-hearted sort of.
Is that what you were hoping for?
And so, were you DJing? Is that funk and soul mainly as well, or is it?
Well, yeah,
acid
I do.
House?
I do certain funk and soul things, but I also sell my soul for the money and DJ at student nights and things like that. You know, like I do tupped up on a Wednesday, and there's a lot of the clients. You know, it'll be like rugby lads dressed in sort of nappies and things like that. You know.
So. And do you have any sort of stories from that kind of time? Do you have anything that maybe comes to your mind?
So I was DJing a few months ago, and on the dance floor, there was a student lad. He was always like, must have been a fresher or something like that. And he just came up to the DJ booth, and he was screaming at me, "How do I get out of here? How do I get out of here?" Like, just a pure terror in the man's eyes. And I was like, yeah, the door's just over there. But then, like, about half an hour later, he still hadn't found his way out, and he's still screaming. He's still screaming the same thing.
I'm sorry, I can only apologize. And so, you seem to be a big fan of Mikhail Mouse.
Yeah, I find him very sexually attractive.
Do you? Is it the tash?
Yeah, it's the hairy nipples, actually.
Oh, the hairy nipples. Have you seen them personally?
A gentleman never tells.
And so do you get mustache envy? Because you've got quite a good mustache yourself. Got a little flick out on the ends.
Well, yeah, I think when my mouth comes into contact with the nipples, it sort of creates a nice sort of Velcro sort of situation.
I heard that's what everyone looks for in a sexual experience.
Yeah. Well, obviously.
It's always got to kind of just pull as you leave. And
yeah, keeps you coming back for more.
Okay. Well, do you know what? I don't know about you guys, but I think since Mikhail Mouse had one left over, I think we should maybe ask Alex to down this bottle of sparkling water.
fuck off.
Come on, should we all... Come on, you're going to do it? Go on, go on. Audience, round of applause.
See whose mustache fares better. Yeah.
I might have kicked that over in the interim, but I'm fine. Everybody, Alex Obel downing a whole bottle of sparkling water. Everybody. Chug.
This is an impressive effort.
This is already far better than Mikhail Mouse.
I am.
Wow. We're about over half. Come on, everybody. I think you need some encouragement. Alex. Chug it. Oh, come on, we're nearly there. Oh, we're on the last hurdle now. Oh, he's savoring it. Hey! Everybody, Alex Obel! Right, I think it's time for our main guest of the evening. Yeah, he is fantastic. He is a part of Metroland Comedy. He has just had a short film premiered and at the BBC Comedy Festival in Cardiff. It's now available on iPlayer. It's called Where It Ends. I guess it is my pleasure to bring up the beautiful, the wonderful Jack Robertson.
Acting. Are you one of them?
Oh, thank you very much.
Thought we're a bit all over the fucking place.
So we just put it there.
So I just thought I'd spruce up your desk.
Yeah, I think it really ties the room together. That tiny little
succulent.
Succulent. That was the word I was grasping.
Did you say succulent?
For. Yes.
Is this succulent? Do you want to try it?
No, it's very dry. That's really dry.
Unlike both of us, I think we just both got a splash.
Did I hit you?
No.
Did I hit anyone else? No. I did hurt my knee, I hurt my knee. But I knew where I was gone. I thought about it.
What you thought about falling over?
Well, I thought if I timed the trip just perfect enough so the YouTube could see and it'd be in enough room, and I thought the water would be, it's like a pratfall. You don't see it say the acting.
No, I did. It was very impressive.
You kind of a big deal now.
And is that, so you're a big deal now, what, because you've got a show on BBC iPlayer?
Isn't it? Yeah, mate, yeah. Yeah, no, yeah. Well, of course. I feel like I've been like a big deal to like some people's phones. Like I feel like some of the sketches. Like I feel like every now and then I'll get some guy who's like really rat. I remember one guy who was still when we were in face masks and I was going to pick up a Nando's and he just looked really aggressive in his fucking eyes. And it because I wasn't wearing a mask, and that's not political. I was just quick, can I get my Nando's, get back, right? And he was just like, he was staring at us for ages with these evil eyes, and he was like, yeah, mate, I fucking love the one with that lad with the testicle stuck in his leg. It's class, that one. And I just had a sketch of a character, the guy with the testicle stuck in his leg, and it was a really intense moment, but it was really beautiful at the same time.
And that was in Nando's?
Yeah.
Do you want a beer, Jack?
Yeah. Well,
what would you like?
Italian? I don't, but I may
Cornish
as well.
Cornish or Italian?
Is that milk?
It is milk, but that's for something else. I was hoping no one would see the milk.
Can I not have the milk?
You'd really be stifling someone along the way, but I guess
yeah,
so.
Yeah, okay. It's been going so smoothly so far.
Have a Doombar. I think you'd like a Doombar.
A Doombar.
A Doombar.
An amber Doombar.
Amber Doombar. There you go.
You got any facts about traffic lights, John?
Facts about traffic lights.
Amber.
If you go through them when they're red, you are more likely to kill a pedestrian.
Yes. Yeah. That's
well,
like
that's
the fact.
Something to live by, isn't it?
Yeah.
So Jack, no. Tell everyone... Sorry, were you going to say something?
No.
No, you weren't, no.
Oh, I've not been saying anything so far.
So, tell everyone about... So that was a Metroland sketch, and obviously a lot of the people on the stage are part of Metroland. Tell us, me, myself, and John, and a couple of people in the audience.
Pot noodle.
That's
sorry. No.
You've been recognised as the pot noodle man a few times, haven't you?
Everywhere I go. I'm not safe anywhere. buying diarrhea medicine in Morrison's, and people are like, hey.
Is that
too many pot noodles? Huh?
Just once, so I'd like it to be the music. I'm like, you know, hey.
Oh, hey, it
no, it's you're the pot noodle guy. I'm like, yeah.
I heard that one about you staying in having a wank. That was from the last podcast. So Jack, do you want to say a little bit about Metroland and your now official sort of BBC rank thing? Do you want to tell the people a little bit about Metroland, about what that is and what that means to you and where it's got you?
Yeah.
Don't be so enthusiastic.
What it means, where it got to. It was literally like just not fucking working as an actor, in all honesty. And they're like, yeah, 99% of the time you're not. I'm like, okay, that's okay. And I think you kind of just had to run with that as a job an actor. And I was like, I've got loads of stuff that I feel like I could do that's quite funny, and I find it funny. So, you know, just...
Like just a man with a testicle dislodged. Like,
yeah. Well, it's found the hack that I found when I went the transition to writing my own stuff was what they said was write about truth, or as much truth as you can find. And when I was younger, I woke up with a testicle that was, I had one testicle essentially, and I was like a boy. I was a young boy, and I just woke up and it wasn't there. And I told my dad, and he was like, "Hey, you what?" And I was like, I've only got one, and it wasn't there. And I had to go to hospital, and they did like a surgery and just pulled it down. It just left. It just disappeared one day. Woke up, and it was gone. It just slipped up there. It just slipped up there and stayed there. And it was jarring. It was quite panicking. But yeah, they had a thing, and so I had, that was it. So I had a whole thing with my groin. So my groin got really sore. My groin got really sore when it went up there, and I don't know why. I assumed it might have been connected. So I don't know how eventually that came to, oh, hey, it'd be really funny if there was a man who permanently had a testicle dislodged in his leg. And then how would that affect him? And I thought, well, what could he do? Well, what requires something that you need to use your legs a lot? An allotment. I don't know, just working on an allotment. It was just improv. That was enough. We were just like, okay, that's the guy. And that turned out quite interesting. Wow, fucking hell.
And you've done, so that's just one of about 30-odd sketches that are online now.
Yeah.
And so can you give a brief overview of that process, how long it's been going and kind of where it's went?
Yes, ended 2019. I had about 9 sketches, and they were just like, the aim was to try and write 10, and I got 9, and I was like, I was being really fucking hard on myself, because I was like, just, you know, you're always, when you're doing like job and stuff, and you're never getting parts, you're always just fucking hard on yourself, like everything. So I just found these select few that were like, all right, and the testicle lad was in there, and a few of the other ones, and they were all, it was a bit like my Britney, that was like my shaving my hair moment. I was like, oh. I just didn't want to fucking. I was just tired of the same shit, and I was like, oh no, I want to do this man who has a Arnold Schwarzenegger accent, and you never acknowledge it, or it's never mentioned. It's just, that's just who he is. But he looks like he's from Jarrett, probably more Jarrett. It was like just this butt rough lad, but he speaks like, I fucking love sweet potato mash.
My favorite quote is, and I'll try and attempt it, but if you can't take the heat, get out of the conservatory.
Yeah, conservatories get really hot, man.
Yeah. And then that was 2020.
So 2019, and then I met up with Caden. I had a few like ways of thoughts. I thought I could have done this. I was like, all right, I can either sit on these scripts and, you know, just wait until there's a point in time where I'm suddenly like established as an actor to even make it. And I'm like, well, I'm just going back on the whole reason why I want to do it. The whole point is I want to do it now, and I want to do it immediately. And it was me and Caden doing student films, and we were always linked to the same people creating stuff. And it was like, I know a guy who is equally as hungry to just like get something off the ground. And it was the the first one that we did, it was like, it was just an act. It was a, again, just drawn from truth. I was like, I just had this actor character who was probably drawn from a lot of Brent. He's just really delusional, and he just thinks he's the dog's tits, and he's just an out of work act. He's a nobody essentially. There was a bit where he was looking at the scene in Atonement, you know, like that massive wanna where there's like, I don't know if this is a sort of war film. There's a big one shot, and it's got loads and loads of extras, like thousands and thousands of extras. And he's sitting looking at that, and he's just chatting at the camera like, yeah, you know, I guess the best thing about being an actor is just being able to create, you know, being able to really move people and, you know, go, oh, there I am. Did you see it? Anyway, I'll rewind it back. And it was just like, you know, like which was a lot of the case that if anyone's ever done any extra work, there is a percentage of people who are like, no, I'm an actor. And then they'd be like, oh, okay. And it's like, what you done? It's like, oh, I've done like 12 seasons of this. It's like, what, in the trees? Like, you know, it's just in there is that kind of.
But that one specific shot is actually personal to you, isn't it? Because it's an award-winning shot.
Yeah.
But
he's gonna love this. Yeah. My uncle Peter Robertson essentially, he filmed that shot. He was the Steadicam operator on that shot. Steadicam op has been that's been his whole jam. Like ever since I was young, it was always they were saying like, oh, Pete's doing a film, or Pete's doing like he's, so it was, oh, Pete's in Berlin or some shit, and it was cool, man. But we never made the crossover. It was, what was mad was that he literally works in it like to the point, and this, I hate that you brought this up on a podcast. It sounds like proper fucking drop, but like. Motherfuckers work with like Tom Cruise and shit. Like he'll just come out, we'd be like, oh, I'll be with Tom Cruise, and he'll just kind of, you know, and the cat family are conditioned to be like, oh wow, all right. Like we're just, you've heard that many names, you're just like, cool, all right. It just doesn't get through. But to me, I'm like, it's like I can't fucking believe that. but he is so disconnected as well from it, because the camera, the terms of casting crew, it is just such a different process. So where it ends has felt like quite a nice circle point for us, where, you know, steady cam operator, he's done the fucking nine, man, yeah, and he won a cheeky little award for that one shot.
Yeah, for Atonement.
Atonement, yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's Jack's Peter uncle. Robertson. We're here for Jack.
Jack's
right?
Uncle.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he's a good.
He has got good blood. Right. He has got good blood. And then, so tell us about where it ends and how that came about and you know, the process of that and. Mm-hmm. And then going, you went to Cardiff at the weekend to see it premiered.
Yeah, that was crazy. The Where It Ends was like a wonderful, beautiful combination of just being able to meet the right people on the process of starting Metroland and people knowing about it. And it gets easier when you go into conversations because, you know, there's a chance they might have seen it and it's good to explain and it's... And all that hard work that you feel like you've got to that point, it was all that mixed with the end of the tax break in March.
They needed rid of the money.
And it was one of those things where it was, they say that it's like it is, there's that bit of luck that's got to be in there. And it was because it's hard to get things through the door. I think that's fair to say. And I think what we do with Metroland is, great to a lot of people, but I think in other instances people get a little scared and get a little itchy, so it is hard to get like anything through those, like, you know, BBC's perfect gates, you know, so it was beautiful. And then once we got going, the BBC and who you work with in your team is totally different, man, and they were fantastic. Tiger Aspect, fucking Mr. Bean, like that was enough for me. Like, do you want to see something that we've made in the last 10 yet? That Mr. Bean, yeah, like get us in that, people.
And so, what is it about? Tell us what it's
oh,
about.
Oh, sorry, yeah, it's based off a two-person pantomime that I did around care homes, and it was a tour. That was a part of what I did as a job and actor, and just I wasn't a writer at the time, but there was a lot of things that were happening that was like, oh my god, I've just got to write that down because that is mental what's just happened. And you're kind of going into it as a twice as much respect for carers, because I'm not a trained carer, I'm going in there as an actor. So you really just kind of you just live and you're part of it, and they always say that you're connected to your audience, and there was this like connection that I felt constantly going to these different care homes, and you get a little conditioned to it, but sometimes it is just a bit jarring, and you know, you're there to do one job, to just kind of like provide a bit of joy and distraction, but the thin line between like joy and like terror is like really thin. So it's hard, you know, coming out as like the evil queen and that, like, ah, my children, and then they're like, you know, you can't. there was a beauty in it, I found this out at the screening as well, like, it kind of gives you a choice sometimes. Like, I think sometimes it feels both truly funny but just a bit crushing at the same time, and it's just the line of comedy, how close it is, and you know, we're constantly like doing that at Metroland, but it was kind of just, no pun intended, but a bit of a blur, in all honesty. It kind of just went and came so fast, and you're just so used to doing it and making it, and we go really fast, and it's amazing, it's great, but I don't know, like, I feel like in that same attitude that I had of those 9 scripts, I'm still kind of on that at this stage, I think, and I'm just kind of...
And so what's next?
I'm doing Jerry and Sewell at Live Theatre at the end of the year, which is really cool.
Based on Purely Belter, yeah?
Based on Purely Belter, aye. That's, thank you.
Oh, wow.
We are doing the Durham Fringe Festival in July, 29th and 30th of July, Durham Fringe. I know that's like... Peak holiday time, that, like.
That's Maryland Comedy.
But Maryland Comedy, yeah. Live. Maryland Comedy Fringe Live, Durham Fringe Festival.
And, yeah, okay, wow. So, to end this, right.
Was that all right?
No, it's great. You're great. It's on iPlayer now. So, if anyone wants to watch Jack's film, it's on iPlayer now, either the BBC Comedy Shorts or type in Where It Ends. Has anyone already seen it?
Fucking hell.
It was great, wasn't it? Yeah. Unreal. Unreal is the consensus of the room. And just before you go, Jack, I typed into ChatGPT, my little friend, the description of Where It Ends. And we have a little sketch to perform. Yeah. So this is the ChatGPT version. So if you have seen it on iPlayer already, you'll know this will be vastly different, and if you haven't, well, it might be a nice little pleasant surprise. So I'm going to give you these. We're going to welcome Hendrika Tsuguru Big onto the stage.
Hey.
No. Oh. Two each. It's a two-pager. Two-pager. Do you want to stand up, Jack? There are three. So the title is The Unforgettable Performance. There's three characters: Terry, an actor struggling with his role in an off-season pantomime; Lucy, a bubbly and optimistic actress performing alongside Terry; and Mrs. Jenkins, an off-screen audience member with dementia. I'll be Mrs. Jenkins.
Have you read this?
Full disclosure, haven't read this.
Oh, fucking hell. If we sense it when it can stop, we can do that, right?
It's what?
When we sense
no, we're going to do the whole script. Okay. We're going to do it. So Jack will be Terry. Hendrika will be Lucy. And I will be Mrs. Jenkins. All right. Okay, we're going to have a little break, I guess.
Hello.
It starts with Terry. Everybody, this is an unbelievable, unseen performance from the greatest comedic up-and-coming actor from the Northeast. Can we get a round of applause before we get started?
Woo-hoo! Thank you, Wembley. Lucy, I can't shake off this feeling of emptiness, you know, performing in a care home for people with dementia. So specific. It's not what I imagined for my acting career.
Oh, Terry, I understand how you feel, but remember, we have the power to brighten someone's day, even if they might not remember it for long. Our performance can bring moments of joy to those who need it most.
I guess you're right, but it's still challenging for me to find the enthusiasm for this role.
Oh, how lovely. The theatre, such talent.
Did you hear that?
Terry, that's Mrs. Jenkins. She's one of the residents here with dementia. She often imagines herself back in the theatre.
Really? Well, I suppose it won't hurt to perform for Mrs. Jenkins, as she were in the audience, even if she's not physically here. Oh, Terry and Lucy stepping up. Makeshift stage in care home. The room is filled with elderly residents, some in wheelchairs, others seated. Terry notices an empty chair and imagine Mrs. Jenkins sitting there. Oh, look, Lucy, there she is. Mrs. Jenkins. Our biggest fan.
Oh, Mrs. Jenkins, you're looking radiant as ever.
Terry and Lucy begin their pantomime routine, delivering exaggerated gestures and comedic actions. The audience watches with mixed reactions, occasional smiles, laughter, and blank stares.
Look, Lucy, there she is. Yeah, look, Lucy, Mrs. Jenkins, she seems to be really engaged.
That's the magic of theatre, Terry. It transcends time and connects with people on a deeper level.
Terry and Lucy perform with increased energy. Drawing laughter and engagement from the audience, Mrs. Jenkins occasionally reacts, clapping her hands or chuckling.
Oh, look out! Here comes the clumsy pirate!
Lucy, pretending to be a pirate, stumbles and falls, eliciting laughter from the residents, including Mrs. Jenkins.
Call back.
And this, so seen backstage after the performance, Terry and Lucy are removing their costumes.
Lucy, did you see Mrs. Jenkins? She was laughing and clapping. It's like she was transported back to the theatre, even for just a little while.
I told you, Terry. Our performance has the power to reach people in ways we can't always imagine. And who knows, maybe we're making more of an impact than we realise.
Terry's mood lifts. And a newfound sense of purpose shines through.
You're right. It's not about the grand stages or the roaring applause. It's about connecting with people and bringing joy, even if it's for just that one fleeting moment.
They share a warm hug. Scene fades out as Terry and Lucy exit, ready to bring laughter and happiness to the next care home. End of sketch.
You know what? For a second, I was getting really worried. I was like, that's genius.
Sorry, can I just say, after using ChatGPT, I think every writer has a job still. There was a note at the end, this from ChatGPT. Note, the sketch emphasizes the importance of finding purpose and joy in any situation. Even when circumstances seem challenging, it highlights the power of comedy and performance to bring temporary happiness to those in need, regardless of the saying. How fitting, how fitting.
I wasn't listening to that, so.
What do you think? What do you think? How does that compare to Where It Ends?
You know, like I said, when it started really, I was like, oh man, that's pretty good. And then it just quickly ascended into madness. So.
I didn't realise Mrs. Jenkins wasn't actually there.
Yeah, I was a bit lost. Yes, myself, I didn't know whether Miss Jenkins was there or not. I just liked how he kept mentioning her.
Okay, right. Well, Jack, thank you so much. Everybody, the greatest new up-and-coming talent of... from the Northeast. Where It Ends on BBC iPlayer right now. We'll be on BBC Three shortly as well. Okay, it's time for another audience member. Let's see. How's everyone feeling? Everyone feeling all right? Everyone's nervous now. I did say I would get Scranavis up. How many marks are in the audience? It's the one... It's just the one who specifically asked me to not get him up, so, because he's on crutches. So invite Scranibus to the stage.
I didn't mean it.
You were mean. You were mean. Here's your keys back.
Thanks, darling.
Do you know what? Before this, who wants... Should we take this just somewhere a little bit different? I have right here... Hot sauce.
Oh, for fuck's sake, man.
Called Mad Dog 357. It's called Mad Dog 357 because it has 357 Scovilles on the Scoville rating. Do you know what that means, Granadis?
357 isn't very hot. Are you sure about
357,000.
Oh, well.
Did I not say 1,000?
No.
Oh, sorry. Hold on. Mad Dog 357. It's called Mad Dog 357 because it has 357,000 Scovilles on the Scoville chart.
Thanks.
Yeah. John, do you know what I like about you?
What?
You're a specific man.
You don't want to be giving misinformation to people.
I don't. I really don't. Thank you.
Sorry.
Thank you very much.
You good?
Who wants to see this interview take place whilst on hot sauce?
I feel like my arsehole is going to hurt later.
You don't bum drop it, bro. You just...
Oh, well, in that case...
Oh, hold on.
Scran, just before you do this... read number 4 just into the mic to everybody. Into the mic. Can you read it?
You know we can't.
I hereby disclaim, release, and relinquish. It's a fucking disclaimer.
Yeah, for legal purposes.
All right, let's go.
Right, go on. No, say it. You got to say it all.
Oh man, that's a big paragraph, bro. I didn't pass English.
We'll get through it together.
Relinquish any or claims, actions, and lawsuits that I or any of my dependents, his family members, or legal representatives may have against any party, releasing any damage or injury that results in. I'm gonna die. Basically, I can't sue, but I'm okay with that. Is that enough?
Okay, should we do it? Should we do it? John, do you want to play a little something?
What's that?
Yeah, I don't know. Do you want to? Should we have a little bit of just a little bit of? I don't know. Do you know what? You do you.
How much? Well, that's a lot.
The bottle.
The bottle. Who wants to see him?
Go fuck yourself.
Hi, boy. All right. That good for you?
Okay. Everybody. Should I do it with him?
Yeah. Oh, fuck.
Do you want a beer, Scrap?
Please.
Or do you want some milk? Do you want some milk? That was what the milk was for.
I love a bev.
All right. You want an Italian bev? Do you want to use your bottle opener or mine? I'll put the milk there just in case.
Oh, fuck it. No. Shit.
Okay, Scranibus, tell us a little bit about yourself.
My name's Scran. Next question.
You have an eclectic career already. Tell us something about yourself, Scrat. About your music, what inspires you?
My name's Scranibus. I make some canny shit tunes. Do some pretty shit interviews sometimes. I like soul music.
What sort of music do you make?
A bit of indie, a bit of rap, a bit of pop. Bit of this, bit of that. Next question.
Have you got an EP coming out?
30th of June. Fucking listen to it, please.
I'm crying, ladies and
gentlemen.
Who wants to hear maybe a couple of bars from Scranibus? If John can... provide a suitable beat.
Tough shit. Oh, do I actually have to?
Yeah, come on, let's do it.
Oh, fuck. I can't think. Fuck. I'll be... Oh, fuck. Bear with me.
I can't testify that this is really fucking
hot. I've been feeling some kind of way. Stress, I don't need a break and a holiday. With myself, on the bone almost every day. Won't stop and I can't keep this. Yo, fuck that shit, this is too hot.
Come on, let's do it, we can do it. One bar, let's go through one bar.
I didn't sign up to this. Everybody's on some shit they then regret. Spent too much money, but no, bro, I can't do it.
Okay, everybody, give a round of applause. It's going to miss. Trying to do a bar. Oh, let's sit back down.
I promise I am fairly all right at music. This is, fuck me.
Do you want some milk?
No, I'm good.
Are you sure?
No.
tell us the best thing about what you do on a day-to-day basis in music.
It gives me great opportunities like this. I get to really express myself. And every now and again, I sit in my room and go, fuck me, I might be a genius. Still not true.
Is there a time specifically where you thought you might have actually been a genius?
It's normally when he's had a few spliffs.
30 seconds before I told you to go fuck yourself. Oh, evidently not true.
Sorry, don't take this as awkward silence. It is mere just, it's just mere pain for both of us. John, do you have a question for Skronovis?
How do you feel right now?
It's a bit chilly in here, isn't it?
Yeah, should we maybe trash talk each other?
Aye, you're a cunt.
Next time I see you in a public place, I'm gonna whip your ass. I'm gonna put you over my knee. I'm gonna pull down your pants, and I'm gonna give you something your mother never did. Your true love.
Ladies and gentlemen,
I have
the
no rebuttal. I'm sorry.
Don King.
Man, you look like a boy who went to Neverland and realized he didn't fit in, but still chose to be a boy.
I was gonna do a your mama joke, but your mum's in the audience, so I feel bad.
Do it. Go on, do it.
Your mama's so fat. I was watching TV. She walked past it. I missed three episodes.
What? Say that again. Say it as if you're trash talking us. Come on, have a.
Your mama's so fat. I was watching the TV. She fucking walked in front of it. I missed five episodes.
Man, your mama's so fat. I looked at her. I said, "Fuck, man, that's a fat woman." God, she's fat. She looks like someone who's really, really fat. Man, I swear to God, if I see you singing on stage, I'm going to go up there and I'm going to tell people that you're a little bitch.
Your mama gave birth to you and went, oops.
Is that true? Is that, Mom, is that... Mom, that's not true, is it? My mom's saying that's a genuine fact. Wow. Okay, I think we'll end it there. I think you are dying up here. You want the milk or not?
No, I'm good. Let's go again.
You want to go again? You want to start?
No, I regret that. No.
You want to arm wrestle? Should we arm wrestle maybe?
No.
Yeah? Go on, then. Should we arm wrestle?
I'm left-handed.
What?
I'm left-handed.
I'll do it left. I'll still beat you, you little pussy. Man, I beat you on an arm wrestling day of the week. Even if I didn't even have an arm, I'm still beating you.
Grab my strong hand. Oh, fuck. What is this interview?
Caden, I have to ask, have you ever told a your mama joke in your entire life?
I was thinking of going classic. I was going to go, your mama's so fat, she broke her leg. Your mama's so fat, she cut her leg, gravy poured out.
I'm still not convinced you've ever heard.
Come on, John. Well, come on, John. You do your mama joke.
I feel
my
heart beat in my tongue.
Go on, John. You do a your mama joke.
Your mom's so fat she puts on a belt with a boomerang.
Fair enough. Okay, everyone ready for an arm wrestle? Yeah. Go on, Scrat. Left-handed. Three, two, one.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, boy.
Okay, fair enough. Fair enough. Everybody, Scrimus. We'll probably have him on as a featured guest one day. But he called me a cunt, so I got him on stage to do some chili.
That milk.
You want the milk?
Aye.
Okay. Actually, maybe you should just chug it. Yeah. Chug it. Chug it. Chug it. Chug it. Woo! Oh, God.
I didn't sign up to this, by the way.
You did. You read the disclaimer. Go on, you can take the milk, Rhea. This is painful to watch. This is painful to watch. Go on, take the... Everybody, Scranibus. Everyone enjoying the show? Yeah? Because next up, we have the amazing. The beautiful. The somewhat always disinterested... John Dole.
Thanks, you're too kind. Song for you guys. It's in Spanish. And then I'm going to sing for you what I think it means because I don't speak Spanish. And I hope you guys enjoy.
Of it the floor. Once again, I fell short of the goal. No surprise then that I wake up alone. Time has been too much since I last felt some touch. Went down to action and I feel it start to creep. Three pumps and it's out. You ask me for one more round. I just need 5 minutes, but then I fall asleep. Once again, I fell short of the goal. Once again, I wake up alone. Besame, besame, fuck's sake, mucho. Como si. Bésame, bésame mucho. Como si fuera esta noche la última vez. Bésame, bésame mucho. Que tengo miedo perderte, verte después.
Thanks. That went swimmingly.
John, you seem like a guy who went to Spain, maybe Benidorm when he was 16, slept with a 30-year-old bartender, and now you have an estranged Spanish son.
I have far too much anxiety to speak to any women over the age of 30.
29?
They've got to be like 50 plus, like way beyond that.
Oh, 50? Oh, right. You know, 50's still above the age of 30.
I know. But they're really kind at that point, you know what I mean? You offer them a Werther's original and they'll just give you all the time.
So now you've got an estranged Spanish orphan.
Yes.
So you wrote that song?
No.
No.
No, I don't speak Spanish.
No, so that was just Spanish song that you've interpreted without Google Translate?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. You just got the sense of it.
It sounded so romantic, and I was like, I think I get the gist of what they're trying to say here.
I think you did a great job.
Thanks.
You did a great job, and you always surprise me with your talent musically.
I'm tepid at best.
Tepid, is that how you describe it? Mm-hmm. Okay. That's fair. What's with the sunglasses this week?
Eye contact makes me nervous. So now I can look wherever and you think that I'm looking at you, but I'm not.
So you're not looking at me right now?
No.
Wait. Were you looking straight up?
I could be looking at any of these right now. They would have no idea.
Oh, okay.
I'm not even looking at them, though. I'm just pointing at them. You know?
And so that song itself, why the Spanish in the first place? Why was that? Do you just feel moved by it and you were like, I need to bring this to the world?
Yeah. I heard it and I thought it was a really beautiful song and learned it. And I have no idea how to speak Spanish, so I learned it verbatim, line by line.
Well, the pronunciation and everything.
It's a pretty song.
Yeah. Okay. That's great.
Did you enjoy it?
I did enjoy it.
I sensed hesitation in your response.
No. I loved it. I feel like I'm a little bit far away from the speaker to have heard everything.
Okay.
Specifically.
I thought the sentence was going to continue, I'm not going to lie. But okay.
I think so did I. But that's where it ended. And, you know, sometimes that's what happens, isn't it? 5 pumps and then you're done.
It's three.
It was three. Three pumps, all right, okay. Okay.
I can't be the only person who's done that, though, you know.
What, just three?
Just, like, it's been a while and you get overexcited and you get in there and it's over before you know it.
And are you still nervous of eye contact then?
With everyone, yeah.
So is this very much a look that we'd see in the bedroom?
Yes, with the lights off. It's very clumsy. It's tough.
I can imagine it's like making love to one of the Blues Brothers.
It's like making love to Stevie Wonder.
Ah. So even though you know that they can't see your eye contact, you've got to still look away.
Keep moving like a shark.
Oh, is that helping your rhythm? He's feeling it. You're feeling the blues.
Side to side. Is that not how everyone does it? No.
That's fair enough, man. That's fair enough.
It's all on the shoulders, right?
Is that so if you could give us your top three sex tips, what would they be? Number one, it's all in the shoulders.
Yeah. It's all in the shoulders. You don't need contraception. You can just pull out. I only have one child, so... it's a pretty good success rate on that one. No eye contact.
Ladies and gentlemen, the magnificent John Doe. Should we get another audience member up? Hopefully this is the one that wants to be up. Someone's already leaving the room. Oh, Jack Fox. Jack Fox.
Let's hear it for Jack.
Everybody, Jack Fox.
You should keep applauding or sit down if you want. Oh, no, it's fine.
You got little to no applause in that sit down. Hopefully on your stand up, we could.
If everybody could just leave right now, that'd be fucking amazing. Cheers, mate. Thank you very much. Thanks for coming, mate. Thank you. Cheers. Appreciate it. Good to see you. Thank you very much. Next time. Thank you, man. Cheers. Yeah, see, even the guy with fucking crutches is bouncing. What's going on here, kid?
What can I say?
Stevie Blunder's doing a runner over here.
This is obviously when the scheduled piss break would come in.
Yeah.
Like,
Jackie piss breaks.
Oh, repping the Greg socks?
Yeah, man. You know, for Metroland and what have you. And that's the only pair of socks I have. So, you know, 7 days a week I got to...
The only pair?
Yeah.
What happened to the others? Crusty.
Yeah, crusty. And I'm very broke. I can't afford them.
No.
It's expensive, the price of socks these days.
And how far up in the hierarchy of expenditures are socks for you?
Top three. Behind Greg's and these nice shoes.
Right. And you still option for the
then
next socks.
Then it's like bills, looking after my pets, paying for the house.
So socks go... Yeah. Okay, yeah. It's interesting to know everyone's financial hierarchy.
Mm-hmm. Socks are up there.
Are they?
Yeah.
But... So
also, is this t-shirt with watermelons on? And clothing in general is top three for me. Because this is a mess without clothes. So it's very important that I buy clothes to wear them. Because otherwise, me sitting here with no clothes on might get you a lot of hits on YouTube, but for the wrong reasons.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You think?
I don't like the way that you set that sentence up, and I don't like the way this is going. And to be honest, this is the first time I've seen this podcast. Right? I've seen it on Instagram and stuff like that. I didn't watch the first episode because I'm a busy man. And also Barry's just finished on HBO and I had to watch that.
Yeah, same.
But so far, this podcast is called The Buzz, right?
Yeah.
Should be called Peer Pressure. You're a bad friend, yeah? You're making your friends come up here and neck hot sauce. What you doing with your life, Caden?
I feel
it's
like
a Tuesday night and your friends are dying and you got one guy on crutches walking out.
I feel like just... The one thing I didn't ask people to neck was the hot sauce.
Okay, fine, fair enough.
Like, come on, get your facts.
Maniac. Yeah.
You're enjoying it though.
Yeah, it's good fun.
Yeah, it's good fun.
Natured.
Yeah.
It's nice.
Well, do you want to neck something?
Nope. Next.
I would offer you a beer, but you don't drink, do you?
I don't drink alcohol, no.
I had milk. But,
yeah. Milk abyss is neck that.
Milk abyss.
Scrum and milk.
And so
nice suit that they're making in men's. Hello, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh wow, that's the energy
I've been
that you've
saving
came up
that
with.
One
oh,
the whole
right.
night since I first. Oh, yeah. Yeah. If I get called up, I know exactly what I'm going to open with. All right, it's fine.
I thought I'd look like a regular talk show host, but I just feel like Lee Evans on his like towards just before he's on call.
Yeah, when he's when.
you know, when he changes suits.
Yeah. That's good. That's funny. It's a good. I get what you're going for, though, with the talk show host vibe. Yeah. It's cool.
Yeah. It's the hot sauce didn't help with the sweat, if I'm honest. Yeah. I touched my eye a little bit, and I didn't realize that Mad Dog 357 travels like coronavirus, and I got it directly into
and it
my
will
eye.
Kill an old person, probably.
Hopefully.
Well. All right.
No, that was gonna be my if I ever do like catering at a care home, I was just gonna do Mad Dog.
Just Mad Dogs put it in, yeah.
Yeah, canapes.
Nice, it's nice. Good. Yeah.
with a milk chaser.
Because inevitably, when Metroland does tours of care homes, which I assume is coming out very soon, you can come with a little catering platter.
Yeah. Just
it wasn't everyone. A diss, by the way. It just seems like something you would fucking do. You
yeah, we'll call it the genocide tour.
Yeah, it's good. Yeah.
And so tell us a little bit about yourself, Jack, because you're a very busy man, as you stated. You're a man who operates in multi realms.
Yeah, I am. I'm a stand-up comedian. I'm a drummer in a few bands. I'm a rapper as well. And I'm just a musician as well. I play a couple of things.
And you have your own podcast as well, right?
Oh, yeah. I have my own podcast, yeah.
Yeah?
Thank you very much. It's called Tired and Inspired.
Is that one on Spotify?
It is on Spotify.
So it's a bit more legitimate than this one.
Well, I'm not on YouTube, though. I don't have videos. I'm just all audio. So I'm not nice to look at.
Oh. That's untrue.
But just done over 100 episodes. Scran came on an episode not so recently. Didn't make him eat hot sauce, but I feel like might have improved the numbers.
There,
I know, missed the trick. I know.
He can't rap on hot sauce.
just done over 100 episodes. Just got into the top 100 comedy charts.
Oh wow!
As well, which is mental. Wow. I just do it in my bedroom. It's just me talking absolute fucking waffle for like half an hour.
And you got shared by someone pretty famous as well.
Yeah, I once did it. I put out clips and stuff on Instagram, and once went on a rant about Snoop Dogg. Snoop Dogg's like I'm a rapper. I love Snoop Dogg. He's one of the legends of hip hop and stuff. But the guy is really bad at rhyming, like the physical side of rap, like rhyming words.
The science of rhyming.
Yeah, the science of, to the point where like he makes up his own language, like he puts Dizzle and Izzle on the end of everything just because he can't make things.
Because he can't rhyme.
Yeah. So
hold on. Is this an expose? Snoop Dogg can't rhyme.
It is a little bit. I've got an hour-long documentary about it coming out soon. But so I went on a little rant about it on my podcast and then put it on Instagram, and Snoop Dogg shared it to his 80 million followers.
Wow.
And I got none of those followers following me. Because if you're going to get Snoop Dogg to share something to his 80 million followers, say something positive about him. Don't say this guy's a legend, but can't rap for shit.
It's so good that he shared it, though. He obviously sees all the humor in it.
I hope so. Maybe I'm Snoop Dogg's, like, get me Jack Fox. Like, I'm like the guy.
Like, you're like the opposite of Snoop Dogg, aren't
you?
Yeah. He's a very skinny black man.
Yeah, I am not a skinny black man, yes. Yeah. Mm. Nor do I know Dr. Dre.
No.
Yeah.
Oh, you don't?
I don't, no. Oh. You look through my phone contacts, it's like you, Scranibus. Me mum. And my mum's not Dr. Dre. He's also not a hench black man. Speaking of hench black men. I know, it's just like
Mark from the PV Wonders.
Yeah. Well,
on crutches, blocking our second camera. Last month, we had a GoPro, right? Mm-hmm. So we set GoPro up on the side corner. Couldn't get that working. Could not get that working. So it's an iPhone taped to the top of a chair. It does. Yeah. It looks. It looks
just
all right.
Letting people in behind the magic now by telling them.
This is. You know. I know it looks so professional up here, but behind the scenes, it's a shit show.
Hey, it's working, man. It's all right. You're doing what you can. This is a good setup that John's got over here.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
And what do you think of John's song?
So it's nice to be here. No, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. I'm joking. It was very impressive that you learned
Spanish.
Phonetic Spanish. Yeah, it was very good. Man. Well done.
Could you just give us a bit more of the Spanish? Just the opening bit of Spanish.
Juan Dole.
Yeah. No, just that. Just you. Some of your lines in the opening bit of your song.
Besame mucho.
Como si fuera esta noche la última vez.
And as he's going, Jack, we just remember it's all in the shoulders. Making love in the shoulders.
Bésame mucho. Que tengo miedo. Perderte.
You know what?
Hold on. Is your sex face just constant eye contact?
Yep. Constant. Even when, you know, when sometimes they're flipped over, I'm burning a hole in the back of her head. It's all shoulders.
It is all shoulders.
Yeah,
dropping it like
John told me everything I know.
Jack's the reason why I struggle to look people in the eye in fairness.
All right, okay, there's the history there. Rock meet hard place.
Jack is an unstoppable object, and I am a very movable force. That's
what I'm gonna say. That's the name of our comedy duo.
We just there like, if I just keep doing the shoulder rhythm, it'll end soon.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, Jack, you seem like 5 pumps isn't enough.
Keep it in the shoulders, huh?
5 pumps isn't enough for you, is it?
4.5.
Oh, is it?
My record. Oh.
Is it?
Yeah. Right. 4.5. The half's important.
Yeah. Oh, well, obviously, yeah.
Yeah, obviously. I actually, I figured out my lane when I'm writing rap songs, right? I'll write, like, not comedy rap songs, but, like, rap songs that have, like, comedy elements in them. And a lot of them is self-deprecating, and a lot of them is about sex, because I'm not going to write about guns and cars and that, because I have a fucked up Honda Jazz and I own no guns.
Yeah.
Wink, wink, I've got loads.
But you definitely had sex.
Yeah, I've definitely at least once or twice
had
touched
sex,
a vagina.
Yeah. So you know, man.
Yeah, I tend to write like self-deprecating. So I have a few sex bars about like only putting it in once and being like, and then.
Like what?
Go on, do it. Can I do the bar? Do
sorry,
the bar.
I can't hear you, Jack.
Oh, I can't think of the top
come
of my head.
On, you
but I've also realised that my orgasm noise sounds a lot like a ghost stubbing its toe. A lot like what I sound like.
There's just like some people like with the machines that monitor like supernatural activity, just
yeah,
going yeah. Like that, just off the radar.
Is
yeah,
it the ghost
yeah.
in the air or Jack's getting shagged?
Every now and then in South Shields, my needle just
yeah
for a second.
It's me.
Yeah, four and a half pumps. Yeah. I heard it comes through AM radio as well.
Yeah, I do, yeah. I'm big on the radio. That's all my podcast is me going... It's not really. It's not. You should listen to my
Tired
podcast.
Tired Inspired, everybody.
Yeah.
Check it out. It's one of the top 100 comedy podcasts on Spotify?
Apple
oh.
Podcasts.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if Spotify do like a... They do like a Spotify Wrapped, don't they, for musicians?
I have no idea.
Yeah, evidently. Yeah. What else?
I was going to segue out, but okay. Why don't you do it? Why don't you segue out?
Well, what was segueing into? This is the thing with segueing, is it goes somewhere. So you can't just say to me, you segue, and I don't know what the way
yeah,
is
I
what
want,
we're segueing into.
I want you to go that way.
Right.
Just
do you want to just go that way? Is that what we're segueing? Well, we're segueing into me just going that way, or are we segueing into me going that way and somebody else coming this way?
Well, then I'll segue them coming this way.
Right. Well, this has been fun. I'll be Jack Fox. Cheers. Thank you very much. Good night.
Jack Fox, everybody. What a star. You can go get yourself a non-alcoholic beverage of your choice on me because I didn't have one prepared for you. Well, I did have milk, but Scran got that. Okay, we're coming up to close to the end of the show. We got... one special guest left. Someone who goes by the name Dick Politely. And I think you'll all be surprised when they arrive on stage by their masculine presence. They're sure notoriety, is that, I can't say that word. Yeah, is that, notoriety is unmatched. This is smooth, this was a smooth.
This is a very smooth entrance.
Do you want to go off and we'll do that again?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage! Dick Politely!
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dick Politely, the artist formerly known as the Fanny Man. Feels so good to be back doing what I love, stripping for cash. As you'll all know, I took a little time out to really focus on myself, my mental health, and to really reflect on what kind of man I wanted to be. I was confronted with my own toxic masculinity and male privilege. It was a tough pill to swallow, I tell you that.
I'll do this. This microphone shit.
Yeah.
There we go. We've gone from bad to worse.
It's getting there. Hey, well, it's a live comedy talk show podcast. Oh, there's a switch on it. You mean
seamlessly.
Dick Politely?
Dick Politely. Okay.
Should we do the intro again?
Nope. This change in me, it all started when I was hired to strip at a feminist function celebrating 95 years of women's suffrage. And let me tell you, it was a thirsty crowd. But I came away with a lot of literature that day, and I got myself educated. I educated myself as to the plight of women. And let me tell you, it is tough. You ladies out there, you have it hard. So I knew then that I had to change my name. I had to change my attitude if I wanted to be a real ally. So ladies, I just want you to know. I see you. I hear you. My soul, she weeps for you. Uh-huh. So, without further ado, who wants to see me shake my ass? Okay, so I hear we got a little bride in the audience, a bride to be. Why don't you come on down, sugar? Hey there. I'm gonna move this here. What's your name, sugar?
It's Rachel.
Raquel?
That's right, yeah.
Raquel, great. And you're getting married. When you getting married, baby?
September.
What's your fiance's name?
I don't remember. Josh.
It's Josh? Sexy. What does Josh do?
He's a baker.
He's a baker? Tell me, sugar, has he got buns like these? I'm trapped. I have not practiced his routine. Thank you for undressing me. Now, I just want to make sure that you are 100% comfortable. I want you to know that you are in a safe space. You gotta tell me what you're comfortable with. You gotta set your boundaries, baby. Uh-huh. Is it okay if I sensuously grind on your kneecaps? You want this?
Yes, please.
Thank you. Consent is very necessary. You like that? Oh, yeah. I gotta know, because consent is not just the only thing. It's willing consent. Enthusiastic consent that is necessary. Are you enthusiastic for my ass?
Very much so, yes. Please.
All right. Okay. You like it? Okay. Hold on. Stop the music. Stop the music. All right. Forget about them. It's just you and me. Okay. I'm not Dick Politely, I'm just Brian. And you're just Rachel. I'm just a man, you're just a woman. Okay? And I just want to make sure that you feel totally safe and comfortable right now. Tell me, is there anything that you need from me? Sensuously.
Just more of what you're doing, please.
That's right, baby.
Feel so safe.
You like this? Okay. All right. Well, what else have I got in my bag of tricks? Hit the music! You like this? I gotta know that you like this, otherwise I can't continue. Yeah. Hey, don't stop the music, stop the music. You know what? I love this, I love your enthusiasm, but I actually think I'd just be a lot more comfortable if you would be willing to sign this consent form. It's not gonna take very long. It's just a couple of pages. You just read this. Okay, you got a pen? Thank you. You good? I have nothing else, so now I'm just gonna do this. All right, now I'm done. We fade the lights at end of bit.
Ladies and gentlemen, the fantastic Dick Politely!
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
No, you keep those. Those are a souvenir. Got my love juice on. Thank you. Thank you.
So, Dick, this consent form, before we get started, probably this consent form, rather long.
It's thorough.
What is it? Could you give me the gist?
It's basically, you know, legal mumbo jumbo that, you know, that it's okay that I'm grinding up on your ass. I can't afford to get sued again.
So you were sued before, were you?
Just minor claim, small claims court.
Small claims court? What, you had like a parking ticket or?
Sexy parking ticket.
You trying to get out of it by stripping for
yes,
the...
Yes, I did. They did not like it.
Evidently, and that took you on your courageous pursuit of
feminism.
Women's rights and feminism, yeah?
That is right. And I love my ladies.
And look, if I can ask you right now,
yeah,
and we could be earnest in this moment, what sort of man were you before you found this treasure trove of, you know, consent and feminism and the right way to go about it?
Mm. Well, you know what? I tell you, I was just slamming that ass left, right, and center. And I thought, how could I hate women? My mother is one. But turns out, yeah, I was a real asshole.
Can you give some examples of that?
I used to those women like they were rags on the floor.
Oh yeah. And what sort of man were you previously? Were you like, you know, like a bum guy, a boobs guy, thigh maybe?
I'm a toes man. Love me some toes.
With barbecue sauce, it sounds like maybe.
You know it.
What would you do? Would you get the toes and then dip it in the barbecue sauce and suck that off?
Well, to put it politely, yes. Like the gnarlier the better.
The gnarlier, like fungus and such,
like corns, you know.
Fungal nails. Love me a girl with some fungal nails.
That's that seasoning, right?
Sexy spice.
And so that was the inciting incident. And what did you do to learn so much about feminism?
Well, you know what? I spent a lot of time with Jermaine Greer. You familiar with Jermaine Greer?
I'm not. Could you explain them to me?
She wrote The Female Eunuch. And it just really spoke to me. And from there, I went on. I met the greats. I met Gloria Steinem. I met Maya Angelou. These women, they shaped me. That's sort of it.
Okay. So that's great. But you didn't think, you know what, actually, I'm going to give up stripping. It was more...
How can I do this politely? Yeah.
And so what was your name before that? What was your name? Your stage name?
The Fanny Man.
The Fanny Man.
Yes.
Now, I'm guessing formally, where you're from, that means ass, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes. But I found it translated quite well.
Over here in England, yeah?
Oh, yeah.
And so, because obviously I'm guessing if you're a stripper...
Mm-hmm. Exotic a male stripper, dancer, an exotic, potato,
sorry,
potato.
Sorry, I apologize. If you're an exotic dancer and who's a male, surely females are wanting to come and see you strip, but you still felt like that consent had to be there?
Very much so. You know, I just want all my ladies to feel warm like a nice bowl of soup. Ladies love soup, Caden. And they just want to feel comfortable. They want to sit at home and they want to watch a video about ducks running through a field. That's what I want to do with my stripping.
That makes sense. So what sort of soup is there, if there was a particular soup, like one soup, mm-hmm. What soup would that be? And would it be served with croutons, maybe a drizzle of olive oil, or like a nice hearty bread or something? Could you give me the specific soup a woman wants to be?
First of all, I'm going to say without any context that croutons are misogynistic, so no. Everybody okay. knows a lady's favorite soup is butternut squash and sage.
and sorry for forgetting, but where are you from again in America?
I'm from the deep south.
Have you got a specific and descript place, or?
I'm from where Matthew McConaughey lives.
Texas. Mm-hmm. Austin, Texas. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Very. It's they say Austin, Texas is the blue and the red, the liberal city in the red state.
That they do.
And
they
that does that really accommodate your feminism?
You know, I've found that there's really quite a receptive audience. They say Austin, stay weird, I think is the slogan for Austin, Texas. I would know because I live there. And I found that there's quite a lot of people who enjoy my kind of strip and the sort of careful, very almost uncomfortable type of strip and where you feel like the moment's being ruined all the time. But you know that what you're getting, you can't be sued for.
And that's the most important thing, yeah?
At the end of the day, I make dollar bills. You think I'm gonna lose that in a lawsuit, man?
And do you have a blanket consent for them maybe you know, I know sometimes with exotic dancers like yourself, they like to put bills in the underwear. Mm. Are you okay with that, or do you get them to sign consent as well for that, or is this all in here?
It's all in the form, and I gotta say, any hole's a goal.
Consensually.
With enthusiasm.
With enthusiastic consent.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So if there's anything that we could take away from this, what would it be?
It would be that Dick politely loves ladies. That he respects the ladies. That he hears the ladies and he sees the ladies. But he has got one tight, shakeable little ass. And feminism, full stop. I have nothing more to say. I have not read the rest of the books on my list.
Okay, I think that's a great point. Everybody, Dick politely.
Thank you. I'd like to apologize to my parents.
I'll get that. Yeah. Keep the music going. Yeah. We all consent, by the way. We all consent. Dick has copies for every one of us to sign. They'll be by the door on the way out. Actually, John, do you fancy giving us a little bit of music for this next bit? Something, just anything? Maybe?
I didn't prepare
You didn't prepare
music,
anything that's already prepared?
Give me a second.
Yeah. So, while he's doing that, I think we got one more audience member to bring up, but apparently... I've been bullying my friends tonight. So would anyone like to come up and do a yard of ale? We got anyone in the taker? Otherwise, I'm going to the name. Oh, there we go. We got someone in the audience. Everybody, Chris Martin. Okay, Chris, here. Yeah. Be slow, you gotta do it as fast as you can. Yeah, here you go, Chris. How are you doing, Chris? You okay?
I lost my voice.
You lost your voice. Oh, so it's great to give you a microphone.
Of course.
Okay, well, why don't I just keep talking while you fill this? You want some old speckled hen or some Doomba? Doomba. Okay. Anyone ever seen a yard of ale before? Yeah, you know what you do? No, you never seen it. You didn't put yourself up to it. You wouldn't do it as well. Maybe. You want to see how this goes? Harvers. No, you've got to do this all. Right, okay. So, have you got the microphone there still? I'll still ask you some questions while we do this. Okay. So, where have you came from, Chris?
Forest Hall.
Forest Hall. We got anyone from Forest Hall in?
Hey! Fan clubs.
Fan clubs. Wow. Do you want to pour that tip that towards me? So the art of ale glass, I believe, hold on, tip it this way. The art of the yard of ale is to kind of swirl it. You want kind of like a vortex. Who said vortex? Ah, someone in the back there knows his liquid terminology. This is all I prepared for the show. I'm thankful that we have someone. This has been a show all about necking things.
Oh! Looks like my last bump.
Foamy. Go on, why don't you try and get some of the foam off? Go on.
It's not gonna happen, Ken.
Do you want me to get the foam off?
Go on then.
I'll get the foam off.
Tell you.
That's some of it. All right, let's keep going.
Looks like a very expensive science experiment.
I didn't realize how tricky this would be to fill live.
Shit.
Well, get that. This podcast is going to end with this. No, it needs the angle. I think that's the problem, is we started to perpendicular. And we should have started more.
I'll try my best with that.
No. We're getting this. You're okay with me tipping from this?
Course, of course. We're brothers, nonetheless.
Don't say that, because people have mistaken us for brothers in the past. What would you say is your favourite thing about being from Newcastle?
Just how much of legends we are and stuff.
Can you clarify the and stuff?
Got me thinking too deeply that no.
What do you like to do in your spare time?
Just try not to think about what I've done in my main time.
Can you enlighten us with some stories?
No.
What you been doing over the past week?
Come back up from Manchester for my mate's wedding. Mint.
Your mate's called Mint?
It's called Gary. It's called Gary.
The wedding was Mint.
Wedding was Mint. Stag do was Mint.
Where was the stag do?
Liverpool.
Liverpool. Was Liverpool Mint?
Oh, it was full.
No, we're getting this full up. We're getting there.
You're fucking never going to get that
full. I think the neck...
Got too much gas in it.
Come on, just keep
I'll
telling
try,
us about
I'll
you.
Try.
No.
Oh, Liverpool. Right. Liverpool was Mint. One of my... it was two stags. And then my friend bought a dwarf and handcuffed them to the two stags. It's kind of funny, like.
Is that still a legal practice, is it?
Way, I'm not too sure, but now we're doing me.
We're getting there. Look, it's I think this whole bit here, not to look like I'm wanking off a giant.
It does look like you're wanking off a giant. Oh, yeah. No.
This bit here is very thin, so I think this is going to be easy to fill up. It's just filling up this bulbous bit at the bottom, which could evidently be the giant's
the
balls.
The bulbous eye drop.
Yeah. I'm helping you out.
Okay. Good luck.
I'm trying, man. It's really weird. Really weird doing this in front of people.
Where's the milk?
Scran, how was the milk? Did that help you out? It came out of the fridge. How are you feeling? You feeling alright?
Alright,
I'm dying. You're dying? Oh, poor Ben. If only there was some sort of implement.
Is it drinkable?
Oh, it's definitely drinkable. We're getting there, aren't we, ladies and gentlemen? This has been a fun experience. This has been something that maybe I won't do again. I'll do the podcast again, but maybe the yard of ale.
I've just worked out how you do it, Caden.
Right.
You just keep pulling dumb boy until that comes out. Trust us.
Yeah, that was my plan.
Another three dumb bars and sorted. Doesn't work like that, man. Science, yeah. Science involved. Oh. Two more dumb bars and then it all comes in top.
Oh, we're getting there. Look at that. Hold on. Nelly.
Yeah, tell you. Another pint.
I don't know what the yard of ale is going to be like, but the yard of foam is disgusting. that's like a head of a pint you get in London, isn't it?
I'm getting it.
Just keep filling it up.
Yeah, man. Tell you three times now, kid. Fuck's sake.
Oh, and then just siphon off the top.
Yeah, just take it off. Tool, yeah? Hey! A nice little head on it, that's good.
Should we fill it right up, or is that enough? That's enough. Right, do you want to stand up, Chris? Do you want to say anything to the audience beforehand?
I really love my mum and...
Okay, well, do you want to stand in the middle there? I think it's going to get messy. Away from the wires, but yeah. Right, I'll stand next to you. Ladies and gentlemen, the final thing of tonight, The Yard of Ale by Chris Martin. Yeah, I think you want to twizzle it. It's going. You're getting there. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You got to twist it. Yeah, yeah. Oh, oh, and then start twisting. Yeah. Oh, oh. It's getting there. It's getting there. It's only in England, Tom. It's not Newcastle. That's your. You gotta twizzle it. You gotta twizzle it. Come on. Go on, you can do it. It's almost as tall as you. Ah, let's see that. Let's see that. Keep going. Ask me while I'm having a separate conversation. Separate conversation on what's going on, but that's fine. Keep going. Go on, go on. See if you can do this in one. Go on. Go on, son. Go on, sir. Hey, keep it, keep it, keep it, keep it, go! All right, you think you've got the home stretch now, do you? You reckon you've got it? You reckon you've got it? You're gonna smell minging. You're gonna... You already smelt minging. That was the consensus there. There we go. There we go. It's leveling out. Halfway there. Oh, 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 oh. It was nearly a yard of milk. You're soaking. Come on, go on, home stretch, home stretch. Come on, go on. Hey! Go on, last bit, last bit, last bit. Oh, yeah! Divinogis, here, come here. There we go. Everybody, any last words now? After how was that?
Brilliant. Shit, the dumb ball, wasn't it?
You should have went for the old speckled hen. Right, ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Chris Mon. Give it up for Dick Politely. Give it up for Mikael Mouse. Hendrika. John Dole on music. Our special star, Jack Robertson, who's also been doing tech tonight. Alex Opal. Jack Fox. And Scranibus, if he's, yeah. I've been Caden Elliott, and this has been the Buzz Podcast. Thank you for coming. Till the next one.